So next lecture is by Dr. M.M. Ramya from Hindustan University.
Yeah, good morning, everyone. I thank Dr. Bhujangra for giving me an opportunity to share a few projects that we have developed. I come from Hindustan University. We have a Center for Automation Robotics, which actually deals with developing projects, solutions for industrial automation. But then there was a change in the way we looked at projects. Probably 3 years back, I had an opportunity to meet Professor Banu. And that was when he just asked me one question which hit me so strong. He was asking me about my research area, and I was briefing about all the academic research publications, the methods that we were developing and all that. And then he said, how is it going to benefit the society? I had no answer to it. And that was the day when we started looking at, you know, we need to develop at least, you know, 50%, let it be on the industrial automation, the methods they develop, the academic research, the core technology and all that. But on the other hand, we thought of developing some projects which would actually benefit the society as well. So I thank you, sir, for that one question that you asked me. Fine. So coming into today's topic, this is one area we thought of looking at. Open defecation in India. Government has come up with so many schemes saying Swachh Bharat or you know, having public toilets and all that. One speaker yesterday rightly pointed out, you know, they have public toilets, but still people are using the streets. So this is as per the report that we've got from UNICEF 2016, which says we have 569 million people as a burden to, you know, as a burden for open defecators in India. So this actually is, you know, the video that you see there is in my hometown, where the social workers are actually using their hands in order to clean the solid waste. When we looked at the facts, they still use the traditional plates and brooms. Tamil Nadu alone has 30,000 sanitary workers, out of which more than 90% are from a particular community, and again 60% of them are women. So what kind of hygiene would they have? They are more prone for respiratory diseases or contagious diseases. And considering this into a major factor, Supreme Court has ordered saying we should not have any manual scavenging. But till date, this is in practice. So the need was, we thought, why not we develop a technology in order to handle this waste. Now this is a prototype that we developed, and we came out with this machine, which can actually, you know, you can take this machine on roads and collect the solid waste. There is a small brushing unit at the front which could brush, take the, scoop the solid waste and then put it inside a container that is available. So here we had an electric unit, the power supply, which can actually give energy for the actuators, the motors and all that. But when we actually contacted corporations and a couple of social workers, they said the weight has to be reduced, the cost reduction should be there. So we are trying to make it totally mechanical, removing the electrical part from it. And then there should also be a flushing option. In fact, we missed that part of feature in developing this prototype. They said when you don't want anybody to touch the solid waste, then how would you clean this unit when you don't have a feature? So now we are actually incorporating these three features into the prototype, and then probably we'll go to the market. The next area where we were concentrating was healthcare. This problem came from a physiology doctor from a neighboring institution, Chettinad Medical University. Now, one serious disorder is due to the overusage of mobile phones and computers. Generally, the way we use is, you know, we hold the mobile like this and we keep operating it. And this actually causes a serious neural disorder in your hands. And the way they were, you know, conservatively testing was that, you know, they just hold your hands like this. They ask you to press the fingers. Depending upon the angle of movement and the frequency of movement, they try to diagnose whether you have a neural disorder or not. So they use the existing method of using is they use such a, you know, scale attached with the protractor to find the angle of movement. Now we just gave this as a problem for a BTech student, wherein we tried connecting the bending sensors and the force sensors to each finger, so that as you move, the angle of the movement in each joint was measured, and we attached a force sensor on the other side of the finger. So as you press, the force also is measured, a statistical curve is plotted, and then based on a threshold, you try to analyze, you know, the severity of the disease. The data logging was available so that the post-treatment, as the treatment was going on, you can also see what level of improvement is available in terms of the movement of the joints. Now, this was interesting when we looked at the heritage as a problem. India is a house of, you know, rich heritage and culture. One intangible heritage that we looked at was puppetry. The advantage of having puppetry as a skill for children, it's listed down there, I don't want to read them. Fine, but then what is the state of puppetry today? There are so many news articles and debate happening on what is the current state of this art. It's slowly dying. And there was one NGO called Dakshin Chitra under the Madras Crafts Foundation. We happened to visit. It was a family tour, actually. We planned it on a weekend because only on weekends we have a puppetry show there. So my kids actually wanted to go there, especially for this puppetry show. But unfortunately, when we went, the puppet show was not happening. When we inquired, they said the puppeteer was sick. Okay, they were not able to showcase that show. He is the only puppeteer in and around 200 kilometers of Chennai. He's the only puppeteer available today, and he's Mr. Selvaraj. We are in touch with him. And thanks to DST, because DST recently announced a scheme saying how can you represent the Indian heritage or culture in digital space. So I was trying to relate, you know, these two are entirely two different areas. So how do I connect this heritage or culture to technology or represent it in digital space? And probably the problem that we already discussed, trying to find the bending, measuring the bending or the hand movement, we thought, why not? The entire puppetry is only based on the hand movement, so why don't we actually measure it and then probably represent it using a robot? So we went, met him and said, can you just show me a couple of movements? And he showed it, and we were confident that yes, this can be represented in a digital space. So we said, we want to develop a robot which can actually do your puppetry. Like, he was so fascinated. So he said, do you think a robot can do this? So this is the plan. This was conceptualized just 3 months back, so we don't have right now a prototype to show, but then the methodology is we want to study the puppetry right from the anatomy of the puppet, how the movements are happening. We want to actually acquire the motion skills that they have, do a motion transformation. The first thing is, now, as he says, most of these puppeteers are like 60 plus, or probably even the lowest, youngest puppeteer is like above 50. And I don't think after 10 or 15 years, they still will continue to do this. So the first thing was, we want to document this art, at least in an engineering perspective. That is our first objective. The second objective is try to simulate this and convert it into a robot which can do this show, take it ahead. Okay. And then probably, you know, develop a system which can actually train. Yeah, this is the final slide. When we actually thought of how puppets will help the special schools in order to, you know, encourage their physical motor skills and their speaking skills and all that, there is a personal teacher for every special child. So what she does is, you know, in order to improve their speaking or listening ability, they keep speaking to them often, or they ask them to repeat a same word or a rhyme over and over again. But that needs a lot of patience. So they now found that, you know, even a small application like Tomcat application, they ask the child to speak to the app so that it returns the voice in a cat kind of a, you know, a voice. So we thought, why not a robot replacing that, which can actually listen to a speech and probably correct the child in order to speak properly, listen properly. So we were asked to showcase that robot in a conference which was organized by Apollo. So they sponsored us for organizing. Now we have got two special schools contacting us for some developments in this project. Thank you.